All right, everybody, welcome to Don Cherry's Grapevine. Tim, we got that. Who was the guy that sang Heard It on the Grapevine?
Marvin Gaye and Creedence Clearwater Revival were the two biggies. Right?
That's right.
I think Marvin Gaye, we got it off Marvin Gaye.
Yeah.
But we've had a lot of mileage out of that grapevine. First, it was what, a TV show, right? Then that we had. And then we had the restaurants called the Grapevine. Now we have the podcast called the Grapevine.
You know, I never forgot. I got to tell you a story. This is unbelievable to me. I had a partner, pretty good guy, and he put up all the money. And he took all the chances on the first bar. So we were going along, we call it Don Cherry's Restaurant. It was pretty good.
Well, Grapevine, yeah.
Yeah, but we could...
It Grapevine was Restaurant.
Don Cherry's Restaurant. And we packed them in Hamilton, Ontario. And
Main and Walnut. I think it's a dollar store now.
Yeah, so
dollar
sad.
Dollar store?
Yeah.
Boy, it was... Anyhow, we packed them in. So about, I think about 10 years later, he's Don... We want to go more to a restaurant. I said, okay, if you know more about it than I do. And he says, we want to be known for food, not just, okay. He says, we're changing the name from restaurant to sports grill.
Yeah.
Oh, wait a minute, hold on. Like, we want to make it a restaurant, we're changing. So anyhow, that was.
Yeah.
So anyhow, that's it. And
just before we get started, Dad, I just want to address something that happened last week. You and I and Cindy were talking about Adam Fox winning the Norris Trophy, right?
Yeah.
And then everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people were saying how, oh, Don Cherry doesn't think Adam Fox is a good defenseman.
I never said he was a good defenseman. I said he was a good defenseman. I just didn't think he was good enough to win the Norris.
Yeah, I don't think he was the best. And that's the way it is now, right? Like, if you say something, like, not even derogatory, you're just saying, I don't think he's the best defenseman in the league.
Well, I tell you the truth, I didn't even, I mean, really, everybody said the same thing that I talked to Adam Fox. I mean, not knocking the guy, he was a pretty good defenseman, he had pretty good numbers and everything, but do you really think that he's in the category of Bobby Orr or Raymond Bourque? Or
yeah, but no, but I mean, this year, like Victor Hedman, and again, you look at the players. The players didn't vote that. The players voted Hedman the best defenseman.
Well, he is the best defenseman.
But it's funny just how...
Who voted that? I think it's the writers voted.
Writers vote that, right? Right.
Well, they're the same people.
Well, you and I were talking about Jacob Chychrun. He had 18 goals. If Jacob Chychrun, who was in Phoenix, got 18 goals this year, if he was in New York, he would have won best defense. He would have won the Norris.
Well, 18 goals. I mean, he had over four times as many goals.
Anyway, I just wanted to say how we're not saying he's a bad defenseman. We're just saying he's not the best defenseman in the league right now.
Yeah, I didn't say he was a bad defenseman. That was ridiculous. What a couple of other things I've said that people jump all over. So at least they're listening anyhow.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, hey, Tim, you and Cindy. No, it was Cindy. It was
me,
you.
It was me, yeah. Yes.
You mean there was a couple of guys that... what the hell did you do? They faxed you or?
No, they were texting us or they sent us a message on Facebook.
And David from China.
He's listening, yeah.
But you were saying that China.
Well, the reason we didn't mention China is because you can't get the statistics because China has what they call a firewall. And like they kind of censor or look, see what's coming in or coming out on the internet. Mm. But you can, what is it called? Dell VPN or something like that. You can get, and you can listen to it.
Well, so. David's a little upset that we didn't mention him in China. Kevin from Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
He must be with the oil guys,
I guess. So Dad, you talk about China, David's in China. They're talking about the Olympics. You're not a big fan of the NHL guys going
no,
to the Olympics.
I never liked the Olympics. I liked it when it was over here. I didn't have to go. But I never liked it anyhow. I have to laugh at people that said they never, and then they went out. No, I never liked it.
No, I'm saying that you don't like the NHL players playing.
No, because, well, I go back to,
Patrick Jarrett.
Jarrett. We were all set, and we got it.
He was just, I don't know, he was our first-round draft pick with the Mississauga Ice Dogs.
And he played good.
Oh, he was like a little Dougie Gilmore.
Dougie Gilmore, and I can't give him a higher praise than that. And And he went overseas to play for juniors,
like,
I guess.
Yeah, it was like, I think it was the under 18 tournament.
He was dynamite.
Yeah.
And he broke his ankle. And we were...
That was it for us. Yeah. Like our number one center was down.
Yeah, like
yeah, that's like people say, it's all great until Austin Matthews, you know.
Well, remember Stahl. Stahl wrecked his knee.
Yeah, and Tavares got hurt too.
Yeah, Tavares. And I think the guy that's been over and got hurt the worst is Kirk Muller. Kirk Muller's been injured, knocked his teeth out. He's always represented his country.
Yeah, I always thought, why not let the juniors go and play? Like every 4 years when the Olympics are on, instead of the NHL teams going, have the junior kids go and play the championship.
Same coach,
but have the World Juniors, because I think it's the same teams that are going to have a good shot at winning the gold medal, right? And they do it in soccer. Like soccer, it's 20 and under, I think.
Well, I don't know. I agree with you in most things, Tim, but I don't... I mean, we can send over a team that nobody's going to touch this. I mean, it was funny, Babcock, when he was over there, if we had played 10 games in a row, I don't think we'd lost the game.
We could have had a B team, and they still probably would have won.
Wasn't it in the old days that it was only the Olympics were for amateurs?
Yeah, that's why the Russians won so many.
Yeah.
Because they were professionals.
Yeah, but they were professionals.
It's changed.
Right, so anybody can play.
So now everyone. So they tried to fix it, and this is what you have.
Well, it's all right for people to talk about going over there. They don't have they have insurance. They could wreck their knee. They could wreck. There's so many things. And as Gary Bettman says, who's going to pay for all that?
Right.
And
Ron was interviewing Gary on the thing, and it sounds like the NHL said to the Players Association, if you want to do it, then you handle it, and we want the insurance, and who's going to pay for the insurance? And I just can't see it happening because as Gary Bevan was saying, he says you got to get COVID insurance. So some guy goes over and gets COVID, then he's got to get
Tim, that's pretty good. But we saw last night. We're doing this Sunday morning. We saw a fight last night.
Yes, Conor McGregor and Dustin Poirier.
What was the name of the guy? The first fight.
The first fight was a guy named O'Malley, who was a really good, and he fought named Chris Montino, I believe is the way
Chris
you say it.
Montino from Portugal, and he took the fight with 11 days to go. And
this O'Malley guy was like he's up and
really
coming
good.
Star. Like
so this kid only had 11 days notice that he was
11 days
come
notice, and he had green hair. So you really figure the guy's a jerk.
Yeah, you think it's kind of a setup, right?
Yeah, setup. It's a holy smokes. This guy would not quit. I mean, I was hoping they would. I don't usually watch.
Yeah, I was going to say, Dad, I was a little surprised. You're not into mixed martial arts as much as boxing.
No,
there's a big difference, you say.
Oh, there's a big difference. It's a brutal fight.
Yeah, but this kid, he just
stood in there. And I think O'Malley took it easy on him in the first round. You know, he whacked him a few times, and he says, holy smokes, this guy is not going down. He didn't
take a step backwards.
He chased him the whole time, and the referee stopped it with 11 seconds to go in the fight, which was kind of, you know, he was very upset over that. He wanted to go
the distance, right? Didn't want to get knocked out.
With 11 seconds.
And it was funny, the two guys, Joe Rogan and Cormier, who's the heavyweight champ, they said the same thing. He said he got his brains pounded out for, you know, two and like up to 11 seconds. Why didn't you stop it in the second? But saying this is what the Leafs need is a guy like that.
You know what's a funny thing? I looked for guys for the Boston Bruins, and we went to the final. We lost four straight. We lost the six, and we lost in overtime in the seventh game. We would have won. If I had stayed there, we would have won the Stanley Cup the next year. But that's what I looked for. We'd pick up guys that were sort of sucks on other team, and then he'd come on our team, he'd turn into a tiger. Well, you know, because the rest of the guys were like that too. And if you didn't, they would shun you. They would, what's the word, ostracize you.
Yeah.
And that's what he looked for in the Bruins. And that's what the Montreal Canadiens, they had a lot of that boy. They had that Gallagher. They had a lot of guys that. That Anderson, Toffoli, they had a lot of guys like that that wouldn't quit. And that was proven. I still can't get over it. And I have to admit, I was cheering for the Leafs, when even though they were up. And for them to come back, I mean, they're gone now. We're not, you know, we're talking about them and everything. But by God, to come back from two games at home.
Yeah.
That was a big thing.
Yeah.
Well, they lost to Tavares, but.
Yeah, but we'll talk about hockey. We'll talk about the playoffs in a minute. But just to get back to that fight, something really interesting happened.
I had to leave. And you saw it after, but tell it.
So if you didn't see what happened, or if you didn't hear that, Conor McGregor like broke his leg. Like you can't believe
ankle.
Well, just and it, his he stepped on like it was 90 degrees.
It was
awful. I wouldn't watch
was it. Was
it
worse than that Joe Theismann? That stuck in my brain from the old days. So.
Well, no, it wasn't same worse church, than that. Different pew. Maybe yeah. one pew back.
Oh, no, Theismann's
it gives
worse.
You willies yeah, looking at
but
it.
But this one was pretty bad.
This was second.
So, but it was something really interesting happened media-wise, I thought, last
yeah,
night.
Yeah, you tell that story. I didn't know that I left.
So ESPN, who has now the hockey rights, they have... the rights, they signed a deal with UFC, Ultimate Fighting Championship. So this, I think this was like their first or second one that they had, they were kind of like co-broadcasting. So they brought their guys. They got a guy named Stephen A. Smith and a guy named Max Kellerman. And neither of them know anything about.
Like, well, they know something. They're fans.
They're fans, but they're experts on baseball. They're expert on football. They're experts on UFC. They're experts on hockey next week.
Funny you say that, Tim. I remember when I was famous. they asked me to do the fight. There was some fights here. I think it was Donnie Lalonde. I don't forget who he was fighting. And I was on with a guy that was a fighter.
I think it was Spider Jones you were with.
Yeah, I don't think Spider was great too. And remember he was on with Chevallo?
We had him on the Grapevine Show a bunch of times. Yeah.
Yeah. And Chevallo said it was really funny. We've got to talk about Chevallo. I said, George, I said, you took an awful pounding when you played, when you fought. And he said, yeah, you speak so well now. You sound like a college professor. He says, yeah. He says, before I fought, he says, I slurred my words.
That's a good one.
Oh, he was a great guy. George.
So tell us, Tim, about the guys that are doing the broadcast.
Yeah, tell us more. I didn't mean to.
No, so say that you were doing the broadcast.
Oh, yeah, I was doing the broadcast. And I think it was Spider. I was on with Spider, but he was a fighter, right? He knew what was. And I was a fan. Yeah. I knew boxing pretty well. I used to drive up to see Chevallo and... Every fight I saw Chevallo fight, every fight. I drove to Montreal. Someday I'll talk about that. Bob Le Curlew. But I didn't know boxing like that. Like Spider knew boxing. Spider knew what was going on.
Yeah, and that's what was happened last night was this Kellerman who's he's a not an athlete. He's got a degree in history or something like that. And, he's going on saying what, and you could tell they're out of their element. And he was saying what Conor McGregor did wrong. And then just Stephen A. Smith, he's going on saying, this is it. Nobody wants to see Conor McGregor anymore, that he's
I'll be dumb enough to.
Semi has been. And then they went to Joe Rogan, this Cormier, and you should see the look on their face as if to say, like, do we have to put up with this? And Joe Rogan, he's pretty powerful now. He goes, I have to say I vehemently disagree with the last statements that we've heard. And he says, I thought he did pretty good in the first round. Like, he kind of semi-held his own.
He did.
And then Cormier says, I'll tell you why he did. He clinched him and caught him what they call a guillotine. It's like a move. And he explained what happened there because these other guys had no idea.
Yeah.
And then Stephen A. Smith, and he says stuff to be controversial. He's at the point where he just wants to be controversial for the sake of being controversial. And just ripped Conor McGregor. And the other two guys that were kind of going, well, he goes, he's going to fight a guy, and he'll come back from this. And he says he'll fight a guy, and he says Poirier will be champ, and he says there'll be round four. He goes, and they'll sell out, and
I'll be there,
and I'll spend my $65 watching it. And,
yeah, you paid for it.
But it was just like my fear is that these guys are going to get on ESPN and they're going to start doing this to hockey, and because they don't know hockey, and they obviously didn't know the things, but they have no qualms of just babbling on not knowing.
Well, they're good, they're tough
and the
guys.
thing is, people believe them. You know what I mean? Because the average fan watching them believes it's fact and everything. It's the gullibility factor I'm always talking about.
I lasted quite a long time, 40 some years. And I remember the very first time I was on, I asked Harry Sinan, can I go on with Dan Kelly? And he was not happy. I said, well, it's Philadelphia, Canadians. And we're not playing. I could go down there. And he was not happy. And I remember Dan Kelly, well, Darwin, at the end of the first period, he says, what did you think of that period? I said, well, I tell you, Dan, but this guy keeps saying commercial in my ear.
But you know, Dad, in the past, people in the press sometimes said that you would give controversial opinions for effect, that you wanted to ripple the waters. And you didn't. Everything you said was from the heart. It wasn't to get the reporters upset or for the press to be upset.
You know, it's funny. When I hear that, what you said at best, they say nothing. They don't get in any trouble. And anything they say, even if it's controversial, they'll never get into any trouble.
That's right.
Yeah, they never criticize. Well, you can't criticize people now, Dave, because just what we said, this Fox guy is a good defenseman, but he's not the best in the league. And we got semi-attacked.
And nobody ever said he wasn't the best. I just said he wasn't the best.
No, we just said he wasn't the best defenseman, and we got attacked on social media. So, you know, those guys, you know, you could see why they're going to be afraid to say stuff. And,
well, you get fired.
Yeah. Well, Dad, as we said, was a good UFC fights last night. That Chris Montoya was 1,000-1 underdog. The guy that we liked, 1,000-1 underdog.
And he would not quit.
And he would not quit. And we just like to thank our sponsors, Spreads.ca, which is a Canadian-owned sportsbook and online casino. You enter the promo Grapes when you sign up and you'll get 10 big spins on the big wheel. They'll match your deposit up to $500, and your first sports bet, they'll give you $25. And so
it's really good deal.
And it's really like when you look at the UFC now, they have the odds, like it's big, like and even in hockey now you can see that, like even in the broadcast you can see how big it's getting. So, you know, if you think you know what you're talking about, you know, like put your money up where your mouth is. That's what everybody says.
I'm an expert. I wouldn't bet on that.
You bet with your heart though. You don't bet with your
head. No, I'm stupid. I bet.
You're not a stats person. You just go with your heart.
No, I bet with the toughest team. I like to talk about Brian. Talk about being tough. Brian Watson. Everybody call him Bugsy. I call him Brian. I read in the paper Don Brennan's call. I did not know he died until I read it in the paper in the Sun. And he was a tough guy, I'll tell you, boy. You know, he played 16 years in the NHL, and he played for Detroit. I mean, Canadians, I think he was with Canadians, and he tried coaching. And coaching, everybody think, you know, coaching is pretty easy. You know, you change lines. And coaching is a lot harder. And I think he lasted 18 games with Edmonton, and then he bought a bar, and he said, that's it for me, get out of hockey.
But well, you've had a few run-ins with him, haven't you?
I did. I coached against him, and I played against him. And I remember, I'm going to tell a story again, that he wasn't very big, eh? He weighed about 180 pounds. He was about 5'11", but he had big, long arms. I remember he had long arms. So anyhow, this is the story. And this is a pretty good story. I think it is, anyhow. It was 5-1. I think the score was 5-1, and I hadn't played. And that was the year I hurt my knee in the training camp, and we had such a defense that I couldn't get on to play.
So you were playing in Rochester?
I was playing for Rochester Americans. We were playing in Quebec, and he was playing for Quebec. And he was really doing a number in front of the net of forwards. So I hadn't played a shift. And Crozier benches Al Arbor, who was a Hall of Famer, and in the National Hockey League, and puts me on. Well, I know. He puts me on left wing. So I go up and stand in front of the net, and I knew Bugsy, and he gave it to me just the same way. He heart of a lion, and we had a pretty good goal. And I'll never forget this. I'll never forget this as long as I live. The French girls, when they used to put their makeup on, they used to have French. It was like a bottle. Like they used to have 3 or 4 bottles. And they used to, and somebody threw, I never forgot this, he threw a package at me or something with bottles inside, and it hit me on the shoulder. And I picked it up, and I threw it, and it went like that. And it was a great big television guy. Great big guy. He was 6'4". And I remember he kind of bald, and it hit him right on the right dead center, right between the eyes. I think he's dead, and he fell. And boy, did I get it in the paper the next day.
Because I remember that, because you say you hit a cameraman, because it was on TV.
No, he was on camera. He was a TV guy, but
That game was on TV.
It was televised.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, that's right.
And I can remember watching it.
And that was a biggie back then.
That was big. But boy, we had a hockey game on TV.
I guess that's why he put me on.
But that's just the beginning, right?
Yeah, so I threw it up and hit him right between the eyes, and boy, did he get it. Did I get it in the papers the next day? He was with his daughter. Supposing that hit his daughter. I didn't mean to hit anybody. I don't know what I was stupid. And I remember the next day, believe this or not, Crozier, I had to I did the paper, the reporters and I were waiting for us to come in, so I came in through the, I had to buy a ticket. What a stupid guy. I mean, how stupid can I be? I'm amongst all these French guys up in there. They could have killed me.
So Crozier made you buy a ticket.
I actually bought a ticket to get into the game. How stupid.
Well, why wouldn't he buy
anything? I don't know.
Were you suspended or something? Or
I was going to get suspended, but...
But you were a player, and he made you...
I had two great fights. I'll tell you about the other one later with Tiki Morrison.
Didn't you guys go at it in the penalty box?
No, I think that was Kiki Mortensen. I did that with Kiki Mortensen. Anyhow, I hit this guy between the eyes, and I thought he was dead. I said, I'm in the room, and I thought I was really, this was heavy. I said, I think I've killed a guy. And luckily, he lived. Get it right between the eyes. How did we get, Bugsy. So Bugsy, he didn't get suspended or anything, and I ended up getting, I don't think I got suspended that game. I got suspended. Didn't matter anyhow. I wasn't playing anyhow. Well, that was what Brian Watson. I had a fight with him, and then I coached against him. And I'll tell you one thing, boy, he wasn't very big, but he had the heart of a lion, and he never backed down. He reminded me of that guy in the fight. What was his name again?
Chris Montino.
Boy, oh boy, that's the kind of guys. That's what the Leafs should have. More guys like him.
Okay, Dad, we asked our listeners to ask, they have a couple questions they'd like for you to talk about. And one would be, I'll give you the three questions we can talk about.
Oh, yeah?
This is that controversial.
One at a time, eh?
Okay, one at a time. It's going to be the salary cap and the referees and Kucherov. And I'd just like to know your thoughts on it. I watched it, and there he was, shirt.
Well, he was the best player. Yeah.
Shirt and talking and bad-mouthing here and there and everything. And what's your thoughts on that?
Well, he had a great 32 points in 22 games.
Does that give him the right to like yap off, or was he? You think he had a couple beers in him,
I think happened, he had two quick beers, and I don't understand though him giving the Montreal fans. Why give the Montreal fans? They never did nothing, right? There wasn't anybody in the stands. I don't know.
Yeah. He just was rambling.
With the no shirt? I mean, I can't believe that management wouldn't say, look, semi-presentable.
Well, what are they going to do, jump in? Of course. I remember Harold Ballard when he died. I'm jumping off from one thing to another. And Wendell Clark we were in St. Louis. And Wendell Clark had an old ripped shirt. And he was going to come on with a ripped, I guess that's how he played with it. I had a ripped shirt on and everything, and he was going to talk about Harold. I called Wendell aside, and I said, Wendell, I said, you're talking about Harold, and Harold really liked you. I said, one of the few guys he really liked was you. I said, why don't you go and put on a Toronto Maple Leaf sweater and look good and comb your hair? And by golly, he did. Anyhow, I don't know why. Don't ask me. They should have caught him before he went on. But
I'm sure the NHL wasn't too happy, because Gary Bettman is he's very conscious about the.
Well,
can you imagine though, Dad, if a Canadian kid had done that and talking about? I mean, I think you give him a lot of slack because he was Russian and everything. But I'm thinking, can you imagine if a Canadian kid?
If it had been Braden Point that got that led the league in.
goals. Oh, he would have been ripped to shreds.
14 goals, I think. Anyhow, yeah, I just don't know. Kucherov, you know, the big thing was, I think it was, he played, and the rumor has it that he practiced with him 2 months before the end of the season, which is, you know.
Yeah, that got out on the radio that he was like 6 or 7 weeks he was ready to go.
Right.
And they kept him off.
Well, they picked up two guys. They picked up Savard. I don't think they could have picked him up. And Tyler Johnson.
His salary didn't go toward the salary cap. Is that the idea?
I often wonder, though, he must have had the bonuses.
Yeah, you really would have liked to heard that conversation.
Yeah.
Like the GM to sit down and say, you know, why are you going 2 months to go? Why are you getting, you might get hurt again. Why don't you just relax?
Wait till the playoffs.
Wait till the playoffs. Because he'll be that'll be a trivia contest. Who never played a game in the regular season but led the playoffs in scoring?
Well, I'll just we'll end with the Leafs, and I know everybody's.
Well, we got a couple.
How about the refs? Like, what did you think of the refs?
Oh yeah, all right, give me the next question.
Well, I'm just saying. Like, how did you think the refs did in the playoffs?
I thought they were pretty good. I thought they did good. I thought they what really killed them was with the players and that, and I know how and the coaches feel. It was once in a while they call a chintzy penalty. You know, I mean, if you did it right in front of them, you don't embarrass them. That the big thing about referees is don't embarrass them. Like Wayne Cashman had a great idea. You go up and say anything you want. He let on he was taking off the tape off the end of his stick, and he'd say what he want. Long as you don't embarrass him. Not to me, except for a few chintzy penalties, Cassidy's remember Cassidy with the Bruins?
Yeah, got fined $25,000 because he was complaining about the because that was a chintzy call on the Bruins and Islanders.
You know what? They were never the same after that.
Yeah.
Anyhow, so I thought the referees did a good job. What's the other one?
Well, we're just talking. You know, this. Well, that was it. The salary caps and the referees and Kucherov and
you know, a couple of things though, Dad. That just that just to touch on with the finals. Was that the one thing that funny thing was that you and I we talked about last week? The three of us were talking about was how much bigger Varlamov or not Vasilevsky, sorry, the goalie for Tampa looked than Price, and they're exactly 6'3", 220.
They didn't look it.
And they showed a picture of them shaking hands, and
they
were the same height, but the other guy looked like, you know, the Tampa guy looked like he'd Michelin.
You know, I can't
look like the Michelin man with his.
You know, equipment. I can't believe when I look at the goaltenders back in those days, they were 6 foot, 6 foot two, but their equipment wasn't wasn't, you know, big.
Sorry, I remember reading an article about Kenny Dryden. He was talking about goalies, and he said somewhere in the 80s, the equipment changed from protecting the goalies to being, you know, making it so that they can
remember
stop
the guy
pucks.
Named Snow, Garth Snow.
Oh yeah, he used to have a 2x4.
Yeah, he looked like he had a 2x4 inside.
But isn't there some league restrictions? I know with the sweaters, right? Because they were using the sweaters almost as like a net. And
well, the guy that started all that was Tony Esposito, and someday we'll talk about Tony. He had everything down.
He had
perfect.
A little net between his legs one time.
He did.
Really?
Yeah. He had like he'd go down a kind of a semi butterfly, and he opened it up, and between the five hole, there was a little net, like a little webbing.
Yeah, and he was the guy with the big glove. We'll talk about him sometime.
But
I do agree that Vasilevsky, whatever his name was, he had the equipment on or the sweaters or anything. He sure looked a lot bigger than Carey Price.
Yeah, and then the other thing, funny thing we talked about was. When Tampa had a 2-on-1 against them, the goalie, he'd come out and play the shooter, and if you passed it, so, you know, and they scored. And the last two goals that were scored on Carey Price were exactly that, that Tampa came, that Price came out and played the shooter. Montreal didn't pick up the other guy and let him pass it over, and it scored in an open net.
And both of them were trying to stop the shooter. And I always had, when I had the Bruins, I'd say, leave it. And, you know, you talk to the goaltenders, they don't want you to come over and try to. They would help rather take the shooter than the 2-on-1. Make sure, don't make them look like a fool.
Yeah, and the other thing, too, just, again, I'm kind of bashing the media here a little bit, but they showed Carey Price and Shea Weber afterwards, right? They're down. And just the reporters, just these very insightful questions. So, Carey, You see your counterpoint across winning the Conn Smythe Trophy and carrying the Stanley Cup for the second time. How do you feel?
we'll end with I remember Ron McLean when he first started out. Bob McCowan, he was coaching for Vancouver. Tell me if I'm wrong, Tim. And he lost in overtime. And Bob McCowan, come on, pretty good guy, come on, right away. And I'm sitting like 2 feet from him. And he says, well, you lost again, he goes on. He says, how do you feel? And he looked at me, how do I feel? Yeah, I tell you, I know how, and I could tell him how I feel because I was in the... one last story about Scotty Bowman I have to tell you. And then we're going on and on and on. He named his son Stanley because he won so many Stanley Cups. He won a lot of Stanley. 11, I think.
Something like that. But yeah. He was from Montreal, so it was like 4 in a row or something like that.
And I was in the finals all the time. I said, yeah, if I have another son, I'm going to name him Final.
Yeah, well, I could top that. I remember one of your good lines were when you're talking to people and you'd say, well, you know what, between, Scotty Bowman and I, we have 11 Stanley Cups between us.
People would go,
you have to think about that one.